International and Competition University of Athens. He is also president of the University of Athens Historical Archive. His research interests include the history of historiography, theory of history, transition, history of universities. His recent publications are on the history of the University of Athens. And as Yura told me, his most recent publication is forthcoming next week, and this talk will be something like a pre-premiere. So, here we go. After this,
good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank very much the Institute, the director of the Institute, Professor, I'm afraid, but I have to apologize that the Bulgarian names are difficult, and also Professor Konstantinova for the invitation and also for the hospitality. It's the first time for me in Bulgaria, and it's very nice. Unfortunately, I bring the rain with me, but okay. So today I will speak. My paper concerns the destruction of five citizens of citizen security file in Greece in 1989. I will speak about the Greek experience, and then I hope that we have the opportunity to discuss about it and also about the Bulgarian, for which I know nothing. So, I will speak about this destruction, which is the largest destruction of police archives international. It did not happen by the ones who had been collected and keeping the files for decades, as for example in Spain or in South Africa, but by a government that was elected 15 years after the end of the military dictatorship of 1967 to 1974. I remind you that this is the last dictatorship in Greece during the 20th century. I will reflect on the public debate that the announcement of the destruction provoked, focusing especially on the reactions on behalf of the community of the Greek historians. My central questions concerns the ways in which historians are involved in this discussion. What is the role of historians when a society confronts its traumatic and sometimes unwanted past? How does their professional involvement with the past provide them with a special role? What are the limits to their intervention and engagement in public life? Maybe can they help to heal the traumatic moments of the past that often divide societies? Can they act like physicians of memory, as Paul Ricoeur has written? Since the 1970s, but mainly at the sunset of the Cold War, many countries experienced a period of transition from authoritarian to more democratic forms of government. In the context of those transitions, associated with the particularity of its country, its history, and its political and social conditions, these societies had to confront their authoritarian past, and often even the evidence of this past, which were connected with collective traumas and with situations that determined the life and memory of a large part of their citizens. There were a large number of documents created to record citizen activities and beliefs, to intimidate and force them to conforming and collaborating. Actually, most of these archives were produced by the police and intelligence services through procedures that were closely connected to the state authority. They were fully or partially preserved and were part of the heritage of the regimes removed through violent or peaceful transitions. And though the countries of the Eastern Bloc and of course, especially East Germany with the archives of Stasi, featured most in the relevant literature, this phenomenon can be observed in various cases, such as Spain, We can see here the Centro Documentale de Memoria Historica in Salamanca, where there are a lot, thousands of these files. Or and in Latin America countries such as Argentina and Uruguay, with the famous archives of terror in Paraguay. At the center of the public discussion regarding these archives were issues concerning the uses and interpretations of the documents and their content, their destruction, their rescue, and their definition of their value and use, either in the context of confronting new enemies or in judicial proceedings for the crimes that had been committed. Let's see now Greece. In Greece, in July 1989, a coalition government between the main foes of the post-war period, the left and the right, came to power, emerging from a significant rearrangement of the political landscape in the aftermath of the fall of the communist bloc, and also against the backdrop of the financial scandals of Andreas Papandreou's previous socialist government. This coalition introduced a bill to parliament on lifting the effects of the civil war, as the title of the bill was. According to the provisions of the bill, what happened during the period from the withdrawal of the occupation troops from Greece until 1949, from 1944 to 1949, was no longer officially considered as a communist revolt against the state, but as a civil war. People who had fought against the communists would be equated with their opponents. Moreover, convictions for participating in the civil war on the side of the communists would be annulled. It should be noted that the Greek Civil War resulted in the biggest war-related bloodshed in 20th century Greece. According to the most modest estimates, it left behind some 70,000 dead on both sides, many more than the number killed in combat during World War II. In addition, thousands of refugees fled to communist countries, also in Bulgaria, as soon as the civil war ended. The civil war did not end with the cessation of hostilities, and not just from the aspect of the issue of the political refugees in the Eastern Bloc. Through a number of legislative arrangements, the government maintained the state of emergency in many respects, elevating anti-communism to a dominant element of political legitimacy. Those considered to be on the side of the defeated remained hidden in silence. They could not burn their dead, claim the honor of their family, or take pride in their bravery and in hardships suffered by them during the war. Commemorative ceremonies referred only to the victors. Thousands of left-wing citizens found themselves in prison or in exile, also because of their activities during the resistance. Members and supporters of left-wing parties had to deal with defeat, silence, and accusation of national treason, leveled by officials and diffused through a massive anti-communist campaign that involved all state bodies and institutions. Up to fall of the military junta in 1974, millions of citizens had been forced to repudiate their political beliefs in written statements. The end of the dictatorship in 1974 triggered a chain reaction of political changes. The abolition of the monarchy and the legalization of the Communist Party of Greece, who were accompanied by a gradual weakening of the right, which was blamed for the dictatorial regime, whereas the demand for change and modernization of Greek society was linked with the left, particularly with a new socialist party, Andreas Papandreou PASOK, which first came to power in 1981. Nevertheless, the repercussion of the civil war and the legal and institutional discrimination of the defeated were still evident in many respects. In 1989, the coalition government decided not only to eliminate all effects of the civil war, but also to remove all evidence of that traumatic past. To this end, it decreed the destruction of citizens' files that were kept mainly at police headquarters but also in local police stations. Those files contained detailed information about the personal lives, religious beliefs, families, working environment and social lives of those under surveillance. The authorities used to have a network of informers across the country to monitor individual citizens and collect, store and update information on them. The police files had not been studied or catalogued. In 1989, there were an estimated 70 million individual dossiers kept in police stations across the country. This dizzying figure for a country with a population of a little less than 10 million may be explained by the fact that it included the files of citizens who had died. They didn't destroy the files because they use it for the sons, for the family, or for the friends of the persons that were under surveillance. There were also citizens with more than one file because they were under surveillance in more than one place. This was not the first time that the destruction of the records had been proposed. As Prime Minister Papandreou had made it an issue in 1984, in the context of the abolition of all measures relating to the civil war. 5 years later, the decision to initiate the police files sparked an important debate among politicians and journalists about the desirability and advisability of preserving these types of documents. At the political level, the main voice in favor of keeping them was PASOK, which, despite its previous position, accused the right of attempting to destroy, with the consensus of the left, the evidence of its criminal policies in the past. Another group that strongly resisted the destruction plans was a group of left-wing politicians and journalists, mostly veteran civil war combatants, who went to court demanding their personal files, over which they claimed exclusive rights, as it was material that had to do with their personal life. But the most militant reaction came from a group of historians who demanded that the files be kept for reasons associated with their professional capacity. For the first time, a large number of professional historians and archivists were united in protest, publishing articles, collecting signatures, organizing public events, and even taking court action. Their basic argument was that destroying the files would amount to the loss of a very important historical source that could provide unique insights into post-war Greek society. The reactions of the historians generated publicity in newspapers and magazines as the press was keenly interested in history and in the past. In the Μεταπολίτευση, the Greek term, as the period following the end of the junta is known, history had come to focus on numerous public debates on the identity of Greek society. Questions regarding the cause of the junta, on why Greece followed a different path from that taken by Europe, or what needed to be done to avoid another junta, needed a historical answer. Many studies published immediately after the fall of the dictatorship attempted to provide answer to these questions. The majority turned to earlier historical periods or were macro-historical approaches that started with the creation of the Greek state and usually ended in the interwar period. They mainly focused on the evolution of Greek society and especially the political system and the phenomena that characterized it, patronage, clientelism, in the last two centuries. Concepts such as dependence, reproduction, modernization, questions such as the Greek state's position in the global capitalist system, and the relation between the metropolis, Western Europe of course, and the periphery Greece, dominated this debate. The renewal of historical studies occurred mainly in the 80s, and it was instigated by a number of historians who during the dictatorship found themselves living outside Greece, mostly for political reasons. their historical apparatus, their contact with the ideas circulating abroad, and their work enabled them to embed Greek history in the international context. Upon their return home, where they were joined by younger colleagues who had been radicalized during the dictatorship, they were absorbed by the third level education system, and they assumed important positions in the new institutional framework. From the late 70s, new history departments were established in the main Greek cities, which helped to spread historical research and teaching at university level throughout the country. History became more independent from archaeology and philology, and drew ideas from sociology and political science. At the same time, a series of historical institutions and professional positions, archives, museums, and research centers appeared, mainly during the 80s. These new institutions turned to the study of social and economic history for the first time and acted as a counterweight to older ones, the Academy of Athens and older universities like my university, Athens University, that serve the prevalent nationalistic and anti-communistic academic historiography aimed mainly at defending national issues. This is not to say that they took the upper hand or that there were no conservative institutions or individuals perpetuating older notions, but the key tone was set by this particular group of historians who gradually gained leadership in the 80s, setting the agenda of historical publications due to their institutional role as well as their appeal to the wider public. An increased interest in history was also reflected in the formation of a number of associations and societies by young or independent historians. One of the most important of these societies has been the Εταιρεία Μελέτης Νεοελληνισμού, Society for the Study of Modern Hellenism, founded in 1971. Its journal, Mnemon, has published numerous papers by the advocates of this new history, a term coined by the historians themselves. New history found its most forceful medium in the journal Τα Ιστορικά, first published in 1983 by the country's most prominent Greek historians, Spiros Azdrahas, Philippos Iliou and Vasilis Panagiotopoulos, all of whom had lived and worked in France for several years. The central aim of this new history was to differentiate itself not only from the prevalent academic historiography, but also from the previous left-wing one, which had been written to mirror the Communist Party, politics and ideology. They opposed what Iliou, one of the most emblematic figures of new history and a prominent member of the Greek left, called the ideological use of history by the right and the left. The main priority of this historiographical trend, if indeed one could speak of a trend, was to liberate history from myths and ideological uses whose rejection was associated with a wider issue regarding the quest for historical truth, the formation of a reliable academic history. As was reflected in the text of the main representatives of this trend, academic history had to be documented in a way that was objective and as a result progressive, since history was by definition liberating. Changing society presupposed changing its relations with the past. In an atmosphere of political optimism, the aim was to rewrite history by posing new questions and modernizing approaches. The Arrian statement of historical truth became a major stake of the period, particularly for the left, which endorsed the reference to and the study of the past with a view to finding out the truth as a key component of its own, the left's identity. New history was attributed the role of emancipating intellectual force. Breaking with the dominant image of the historical past was seen as a precondition for the emancipation of citizens, a sine qua non for a changing society. The pursuit was the scientific discovery of a past that had been muted or falsified for the sake of political expediencies, a past that should be seen under a new light in order to justify policies, establish genealogies, remind injustice, and heal wounds. In fact, this scientific perception would also serve a political agenda different from the one that had been prevalent but equally political, the modernization of Greek society. This is the new agenda. In the late 70s and the 80s, a new period emerged as a research field for this new academic historiography. The years from 1940 to 1944, which became known as the National Resistance during the German occupation. Up to that point, the resistance, which had been associated with the left, was excluded from official historiography. In the same year, 1978, the first two history conferences on the occupation and resistance took place, not in Greece, because, as Nikos Voronos had said, it was too early, but in Washington and in London. In parallel, the first doctoral theses on the resistance period were completed. Written abroad during the time of the dictatorship and primarily based on British and United States archives, they focused on the period because they sought primarily to understand the role of foreign powers and to study the differences between the left and the right in the context of the active political involvement of these young historians. In 1983, the socialistic PASOK government officially recognized the national resistance, which allowed the resistance fighters, mainly left-wing citizens, to enter the pantheon of national heroes. A new narrative was formed, which projected the heroic, unifying and social liberating nature of the resistance as its key element. Although the 1940-44 period was integrated in official history, the civil war that followed, 1946-1949, would remain outside the scope of academic interest until the mid-90s at least. It remained a very difficult period for Greek society to discuss, as it once remained open and the memory of it was divided. The issue of the communistic insurrection was still considered taboo, with attempts to discuss the civil war triggering reactions from conservative parts of society. On the other hand, the choice to elevate the resistance, but not the civil war, in the collective memory reflected the recognition of the left as a patriotic force and also the rejection of the use of violence for political ends and the acceptance of the legal and parliamentary system. Historians specifically avoided the civil war period, invoking as a key problem, apart from the lack of any institution dedicated to the period, their inability to treat it fairly and objectively, referring to the classified character of most files from that period. In 1980, Philippos Iliou was the first historian to publish archival documents of the Kukue on Communist Party and the Civil War, in a daring initiative that was not picked up by his colleagues. The threat of burning the security files, however, put things in a different perspective. Even if the systematic study of the Civil War had yet to begin, the preservation of relevant historical evidence and its transformation into historical sources were absolutely necessary. The destruction of citizens, the destruction of millions of documents, was considered a nightmare scenario by historians. They based their arguments on the concept of sources, in this case, the documented knowledge of the past. Their academic affinities, the commonly accepted rules on how to generate history, had become commonplace, part of their own habitus, which they felt compelled to defend. The historians recognized the fears of citizens that publishing the files might cause pain. They also understood that if the files were preserved, there would always be the possibility that they might be used by the state against citizens in the future. As an answer to all these fears, the historians proposed the strict observation of academic methodology and the transformation of those files into archival sources. They also suggested prohibiting access for a number of years before the documents could be declassified and possibly processed by professional historians. Responding to the public concerns that these files contain biased and false information, they said that even falsifications are facts themselves and proof of certain realities. For some of the historians and intellectuals of the left, in fact, the problem was deeply political. The right-wing party in the coalition saw the destruction of the files in order to conceal their questionable deeds and to shift the blame for the persecution of the left. As the files revealed, this policy was in force over a long period, was spread throughout the political system, and was associated with the concept of ethnikofrosyne, nationalism, which excluded a large part of Greek society from the public sphere, namely those on the left of the political spectrum. On the other hand, the decision of the left-wing component in the coalition to agree to this symbolic act was associated with a new left, as it had emerged from the collapse of the communist regimes in 1989. This left supported the need for national reconciliation and cooperation by tearing up an important page of its history, its attempt to take power through force of arms. But what did the historian propose? They argued that reconciliation would occur throughout adopting a critical stance based on the knowledge of what happened in the past. Historians were against oblivion. As another significant Greek historian, Georgos Detilis, mentioned in a letter to Vilma newspaper, history is collective memory and self-awareness needs shame and guilt. As regards the question of how societies can overcome their traumatic past, historians argued along the lines of what Frank Ankel Smith later called the pain of Prometheus. Overcoming trauma is possible only by gaining constant knowledge in a never-ending process where the study of the past constantly provides new information. We circle around trauma in an attempt to understand it. However painful, the past must be investigated if it is to be understood. The goal is, after we have learned, to accept it and then for a more integrated identity based on its acceptance. The aim is to incorporate the common past in the collective history, to include even those moments that a large part of society may wish to forget, and to accommodate even the most traumatic moments. The past was considered to be a vast archive, constantly yielding new material. In this sense, the files were a privileged field, representing a massive, unique archive of recorded testimony that would help answer questions forever. Despite the loud protestation of historians in the public realm, the Greek government and parliament showed themselves to be indifferent to or even in favor of destroying the files. The right-left coalition government's decision to destroy them was clearly part of a strategy to showcase what was an unprecedented political alliance, and it was not met with any significant opposition, with the exception of the historians. Here you can see photos from the destroyed of the citizens, of the fight of the citizens. They burned them in Halivurgiki. Although the historians' arguments circulated widely in the press and were even raised during parliamentary sessions, there was no change. Unlike in cases such as the former East Germany, there was no widespread demand to unmask those who spied on others. 15 years after the fall of the junta, and given the important changes that had taken place, the files amounted to an embarrassing reminder of a past that will now be forgotten on the political and even personal level. Government leaders, supposedly representing public opinion, decided to write off this aspect of the past. The statement of Konstantinos Mitsotakis, the leader of the right-wing New Democracy Party, one of the two parties of the coalition, which participated in the coalition government, is telling. There are pages in history that nobody wants to read. Everyone would skip over them. Everyone wishes that they didn't exist. Expressing a similar position, Public Order Minister Ioannis Kefalogiannis, also from New Democracy, remarked, nobody cares anymore for this political past. Throwing the files into the pier destroyed throwing the fires into the pier, destroyed historical traces, took the blame of the persecutors, and released the victims from the anxiety over what their fires might contain. According to those who advocated burning them, preserving the fires might become an impediment. It could destabilize the identity of those called to move forward into a new era by reminding them of a conflictual past. The desire to know